Hello children, I'm here to do a very interesting chapter, Birth by A.J. Cronin. The moment of birth, children, before we get to the chapter, we must realize how important and what a grand event the birth of a child is, especially for the family, for the mother and father. It is the ultimate bliss when they can actually feel a little one in their hand. Very often, from the medical point of view, deliveries are not very easy, and there are many complications that we know of. And in such a situation, sometimes it is very difficult for a doctor to keep his nerves calm. This is one such story about a doctor who has just passed out from his medical college, and he's young, he's inexperienced, highly qualified. But as we all know that in the medical profession, your personal experience counts a lot, and he is kind of taking this huge gamble of delivering a child, a baby for whom the parents have waited for years and years. So this baby is doubly special. Every child is special, students. But when a couple has a child, has the birth of a child after a long, long wait, it is the most tensed and most trying moment for the couple, whereby the couple have to keep their nerves together, pray hard, hope that the mother and the child, both of them, survive. So as you look at this lovely picture right in the beginning, we see a beautiful newborn child. Before we get to the chapter, we get to an explanation about the chapter. Let's see what we can read about the author. We have Joseph Cronin, born in 1896, 19 July, and he lived till 6 January 1981. He was a Scottish novelist and a physician. His best known novel was The Citadel. This book promoted controversial new ideas about medical ethics. His novella, Country Doctor, was adapted for a long running BBC radio and TV series. Dr. Finlay's Casebook revived many years later. About the chapter, the story Birth is an excerpt from The Citadel. The story expresses the anxiety and excitement of the doctor, Andrew Manson, and his team while handling a child delivery case in a mysterious way and brings back life in a seemingly dead born child by thinking out of box. He finds that textbook knowledge alone is not sufficient to handle such cases. So as I have mentioned earlier, that he was highly qualified, but this was the first medical case, and it was doubly important for him because the couple were having a child after a long, long wait. And for the doctor himself, it was his first case, his first medical case, which would either create a reputation for him, a positive reputation, or would create a negative reputation. So it was the beginning of his medical career, and it was extremely important that everything went on perfectly. Let's look at the summary. It was midnight, and when he reached near his house, he was requested by Joe Morgan to attend to his wife immediately, who was expecting her first child after 20 years of the marriage. Andrew agreed to go despite late night. And so as you read the chapter, children, you realize that Andrew had just come back home after a trying evening with his girlfriend. And they had been debating. They had been debating about marriage. And though Andrew loved his girlfriend a lot, but unfortunately, all his friends, when he reflected on their married life, had very, very gruesome experiences. They had experiences which had left them tormented for a long time. In one case, the wife walked out. In one case, one friend was going through a horrible relationship. So Andrew was very hesitant to commit. He was sure he loved, but he wanted an idyllic marriage. And he was not sure that he could give this idyllic marriage to his girlfriend. So after that trying evening, he was emotionally exhausted. And when he comes back, he had this person waiting to take him because his wife had started her labor pains. At the patient's house, Andrew saw that the lady was being attended to by a midwife. Mrs. Morgan was very serious. And there was a midwife, like any small place, small town. The midwife, the patient was being attended to, and she looked very, very ill. She looked very, very serious. Andrew examined that it would take some time for the delivery to take place. He took a break and he sat and was offered a cup of coffee, his mind going back to his evening's experience, his argument, and his emotionally disturbing scene with his girlfriend. And on the other hand, he had to be all here. So very often, we see the dilemma of a doctor. The doctor, his professionalism has to transcend over his personal problems. His professionalism has to take the first spot. And in this case too, doctor had to sideline his emotional problems, his stress and strains, and focus on the patient, because it is not like any other profession, children, whereby things can go wrong and we can perhaps just say sorry and rectify it the next time. But in this case, in a medical profession, we all know that the ethics are very, very serious, and that every doctor tries to live to these ethics, and they realize that if there is a mistake, if they don't give their 100% to this, something is going to be drastically wrong and the patient may lose his life. No apologies can rectify that if a patient has lost his or her life due to the callousness of a medical doctor, due to the callousness. If someone loses a life, you can never redo the scene again. In this period, Andrew's mind started wavering in stray thoughts. Andrew thought all marriages were a dismal failure. In the meantime, Andrew had to go back to attend to the patient. Andrew, I've mentioned earlier, in the evening had met with his girlfriend, and she was insisting that he now commit, since they loved each other. And Andrew kept having these images and flashbacks of the bad marriages of his friends, and he was shaky, he was unable to commit because he felt he would not be able to handle a bad marriage with the woman he loves so much. He would not be able to handle a breakup, and it had to be perfect, it had to be idyllic, and he was not sure if he could commit to make it totally idyllic, seeing that many marriages don't work out. After an hour-long harsh struggle, a child was born towards the dawn. But the child was still born. And when you read the chapter, you see, children, how much suddenly there is this whole tension, and people are waiting, and he's trying to calm the mother, and the mother-in-law is waiting patiently, the husband is walking up and down. They're all so stressed, they all have been waiting. This baby is so special. They've been waiting for the birth of this lovely child for the past 20 years, and now all their prayers were going to be answered, and doctor had committed to them and had assured them, like every good doctor, that he would take charge, that everything would be all right. But suddenly he realized that there were complications and the case would not be so simple. The mother struggled in pain, and finally a baby was born. But much to his disappointment, he realized that the body of the child was not the way it should be, that it was a stillborn child. And he had to immediately think, what could he do? There was the stillborn child on the one hand, and on the other hand, there was the sinking pulse of the mother. He was now in this dilemma, whom to attend to first. It was a huge emotional shock for him to see that this baby, who was whose birth was being welcomed by all these people who had, the mother-in-law had been praying frantically, everyone had been praying, the mother had even told the doctor, don't give me anesthesia because I would rather bear the pain than have something go wrong with my baby. You know, the mother had been waiting for 20 long years and she had been waiting for this child. She was waiting for this beautiful baby, a full-born, beautiful, complete child in her hand, and much to the disappointment of the doctor that the baby was stillborn. When Andrew gazed at the lifeless form, he shivered with horror. The mother was unconscious, required attention immediately, immediate attention. Andrew was to decide to whom to attend, the child or the mother. Andrew gave the child to the nurse and turned his attention to the mother. So you can see that how Andrew first gave the child to the midwife, because he realized the mother's pulse was sinking. He promptly broke an amulet and injected some medicine in the mother and tried to level up the mother's pulse first before he would look at the child. He wanted to save the mother first, because in such a difficult case, when one has to make a choice between the mother and the child, the doctor, of course, will focus on the mother, because the mother is important. If mother's not there, and some, you know, the child is not going to live very long, and a mother can always have another child. But in this case, he was not going to give up. He was determined. This whole story is about how passionate he is about his medical career. This story is about a doctor's determination, a doctor not willing to give up till the very end. Taking it as a still child, the midwife had dumped it beneath the bed among soaked newspapers. Andrew pulled out the child. Andrew could understand that it was a case of suffocation due to lack of oxygen and excess of carbon dioxide in the blood. And Andrew, from his past knowledge of his textual knowledge, and he'd heard about cases, he realized that this child had actually suffocated. So first he attended to the mother. He waited for a while till her pulses kind of balanced, and then he was not going to give up. The midwife kept telling doctor, for God's sake, give it up, doctor, this child is still born. And she had heartlessly pushed the newborn baby under the bed with the soiled newspapers. But the doctor was not going to give up. He pulls the baby out and wants to give his 100%. Before he would say that the baby is no more. He was not willing to disappoint himself and the family. Andrew started giving the necessary treatment. He did not lose heart. The midwife again and again told him that it was a stillborn child, but Andrew did not heed. He continued with his treatment. And what was his treatment, children? He worked like a possessed man. He asked for two basins of water, warm water and cold water, and then he started working like a juggler. He started dipping the child in the warm water and then pulling the baby and putting him in the cold water. He was trying to revive the breathing, revive the heart with shock treatment. Then he rubbed the baby with a lot of effort. He started pumping the little pygmy chest. He was not giving up, and he kept doing this whole thing again and again and again. He was sweating, he was dizzy, but he did not give up. He realized that maybe a little more effort would just revive this little heart, which has just stopped because of suffocation. Efforts put to revive the baby. He put the baby first in a lukewarm water and then in cold water. He rubbed the baby with a rough towel, crushed and released the little chest with both his hands. So we see this, students, very clearly, that he was not willing to give up, and he started trying to give the shock treatment to the baby. He wanted to press the pygmy chest. He was not going to give up till he had put in all his attention and his effort with full determination. Towards the end of the story, a miracle happened. He succeeded in infusing breath into that limp body. The little chest gave a short, convoluted heave. The child started turning around. It was no longer stillborn. And suddenly a miracle happened, students. He saw that suddenly there was a little mucus which came out from the little tiny nostril. And in the chapter, when you read that he has beautifully defined this little bit of mucus as the most delightful bit of iridescent bubble that he ever saw in his life. This bubble, why was he so exalted about this little mucus, little bubble? Because it was this which had choked the little child. And with the mucus coming out, the child could breathe once again. And suddenly, like an engine which doesn't work for a long time, there are little shakes, their convoluted heave, and then the child gave a cry, and you know, it was the most blissful cry. Like all doctors say, that till the baby doesn't cry, they are not sure that the baby is well. And the louder a newborn child cries, the healthier the baby is. At last, Andrew heaved a sigh of relief. He handed the child to the nurse. He walked down the street with a sense of deep satisfaction that he could achieve something great. And you see here how happy the mother and father are, how happy parents are with a newborn baby. And newborn babies are just so beautiful, students. You know, you realize how perfect Almighty's creation is. They're so minutely perfect. Each little finger is formed. Each little eyelash is there. And, you know, tiny feet. It's such a delight to see a newborn baby. So minutely perfect. Something only God could create. And Andrew heaved a sigh of relief. There are multiple reasons for him being so relieved. Firstly, he could keep up his promise. The promises he made to the mother-in-law, to the mother, to the husband, he did not let him down. And so we realized that Andrew, apart from being a highly efficient doctor, was also a very, very humane person. He was considerate. He was sensitive towards the requirements and the wants and the desires of his patient. And he was heartbroken when he had seen the stillborn child. He was totally disillusioned when he realized that maybe he will have to tell them the baby is no more. That's why he gave his 100% bet. If he was a callous doctor, if he was a doctor who did not care, a doctor who was basically materialistic, how would he care? The midwife had thrown the baby under the bed. He would have said, I'm sorry, the baby is dead. But Andrew was not like that. Andrew comes across a true doctor who's not just taken the oath for nothing, but who has decided that the oath he took for his medical profession is something he's going to stand by for all his life. And he was also relieved that because this was his first case of delivery, and with this being successful, he had created a very, very positive reputation for himself, and he would now have a reputation with which he would have many more patients. And since he was new to this town, he was worried that if the first case had gone wrong, perhaps it would mar the progress of his entire medical career. And he walked down the street with a sense of deep satisfaction that he could achieve something great. He felt, the last line say, I have finally done something real. Why has he done finally something real? Because it's not just theoretical knowledge which makes you a complete doctor. Only when you can see them, that all your knowledge can be used for saving a life, do you realize that all the academic efforts that you've put in all your life is something which has been finally rewarded. I hope that you have enjoyed this PowerPoint presentation that we have made, and I'd like to thank you, children, for your attention. I hope you have a nice day. Thank you.